journey of our young democracy. In ANC, we were witnesses to the defining moments of Philippine history that influenced the world.
To the service of the nation.
We talk to leaders. We don't shy away from difficult conversations.
ANC Leadership Series.
We don't just tell stories. We tell you why they matter. We sift through the noise and arm you with facts.
We report about disruption and how the latest technology and innovation have changed the way we live.
Told stories about crisis, but also about opportunities that came with it.
The Philippines.
And we are ANC.
The views and opinions expressed in the following program do not necessarily reflect the policies and position of this network.
Welcome to Matters of Fact. I'm Christian Esguera. The Philippine Capital Region and neighboring provinces backed their strictest lockdown starting today, just a little over a year into the COVID-19 pandemic. People are understandably worried and frustrated. Are we back to where we started? Why did we come to this? Is the government losing control of this health crisis? How much of this has to do with incompetence, perhaps from the very top? We'll talk about this later on the program. First, the news. Photos from an international group show that the flotilla of Chinese vessels in the West Philippine Sea has been there for over 3 months. Pictures from the Similarity in All Source show the ships have been in the Julian-Felipe Reef as early as November 14, 2020. They began to multiply on December 9. The Chief of Staff of the Philippine Armed Forces has ordered the deployment of additional Navy ships to patrol the area. But if the suspected vessels of the Chinese maritime militia remain there, a maritime expert warns it may be harder for the Philippines to stake its claim over the West Philippine Sea.
Hindi dapat natin palampasin ito. Na nakikita natin na lumalapit sila, na nakukuha nila yung halos nakukuha na nila yung control ng lugar. Lumabas na sila sa Pag-asa Island, nasa loob na talaga sila ng ating exclusive zone. Talagang inuunti-unti nilang dine-break up itong area na ito na dapat tayo ang mayroon tayong control dahil ito ay ating exclusive zone ng continental shelf. So kung palalampasin natin ito, siguradong mayroon pang susunod.
China has denied the existence of a Chinese maritime militia. It has said the vessels are fishing boats that are seeking shelter from bad weather. Australia said it's concerned about the destabilizing actions that could provoke escalation in the international waterway. On Twitter, Australian Ambassador to the Philippines, Stephen Robinson, said Australia supports the Indo-Pacific region, which is secure, open, and inclusive. He also points out the South China Sea is governed by international rules and norms, particularly the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. Ambassador Robinson joins us this morning. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us on the program, sir.
Good morning, Christian. How are you?
Okay, I'm good, sir. Let's start with your tweet. You were not the only member of the international community that made a similar statement on Twitter following this latest developments in the South China Sea. Let's start with how concerned Canberra is over what is happening now in the South China Sea.
Thanks very much, Christian. Well, Australia's taken a very consistent long-term position with regard to developments in the South China Sea. And what I endeavoured to do last week with the tweet that I put out was to encapsulate that position. And essentially what I said was that Australia supports an Indo-Pacific region which is secure, stable and sovereign. And the South China Sea, as a critical international waterway, is governed by international rules and norms, including the UN Convention of Law of the Sea, which is very, very important to us. And as a consequence, we remain concerned about any destabilizing actions that could provoke escalation in the South China Sea. Now, that's been our position for a long time, and we really do wish to have the norms and the laws that govern our interactions internationally, you know, held to. So that's what Australia would wish.
Now, in this specific development near the Whitsun Reef, which is located within the exclusive economic zone of the Philippines, how concerned is Australia on this specific development? Because you mentioned the importance of respecting international law. We know that there's this arbitral ruling in The Hague by the Permanent Court of Arbitration. Yet, these things are still happening, not just in areas being claimed by the Philippines, not just in areas considered as part of the EEZ of the Philippines, but also elsewhere in the South China Sea.
Yes. Well, that's right. So Australia holds to, you know, international rules and norms, and we are concerned about any action that's taken in the South China Sea that interrupts those rules and norms. And of course, we do subscribe to the arbitral award of 2016. You know, we do hold to that and support that outcome. Because what we really want to see in the South China Sea is freedom of navigation and overflight, unimpeded trade, and adherence to those international laws that we've all used and subscribed to for a long period of time. And if we don't subscribe to those, we end up in difficulty. And that's not somewhere that we wish to be. And of course, this matters a great deal to Australia because we use the South China Sea to a large extent for our maritime trade. About 65% of Australia's maritime trade goes through the South China Sea. So freedom of navigation, overflight, and unimpeded trade through those waters are really vital to us.
Okay. We know that there's also no implementation mechanism as far as the arbitral ruling is concerned, but there's also the aspect of international pressure. Now, do you sense any significant difference with the way the international community, along with the Philippine government, have been exerting perhaps pressure on China to abide by that ruling at this time?
Well, I think there are a range of countries in the region and more broadly that are all expressing their views, and those views are pretty much consistent. And they all do go to those points about international law and the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. And if we're all saying the same thing, that must be an indication of a pretty strong view that countries around the world have about how the South China Sea should operate.
But how do you actually pressure China to play by the rules?
That's an interesting question. Australia doesn't take sides in these things. It expresses its views directly and, you know, without fear or favour. All we can do in these situations is to express our views and unite with others to make our position clear.
Mm. But of course, we know that there's already the PCA ruling, and that's already part of international law. And you've explained how important the issue is as far as Australia is concerned. But again, we know the strategy of China. They've been trying to ward off or drive away other non-players, quote-unquote, in the South China Sea, including Australia. They're saying that they would prefer to deal with the claimant countries, including the Philippines, bilaterally. Do you think this could work? Or do you really need the involvement of the international community, especially those with direct stake in this vital waterway?
Well, I understand that there's a code of conduct discussion that's going on, and we're watching that closely. And that, once again, you know, goes to needs to have as its foundation international law and the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea. But I think there's a range of countries that have interests in the South China Sea, not dissimilar to Australia, that have to, you know, make their views clear and step up and say to countries that are seeking to constrain activities in the South China Sea. Look, this is international waterway. We're coming through, and this is important that you understand that we do utilize this waterway and we will not be inhibited in that use.
How much of China's credibility as far as, let's say, communicating with the rest of ASEAN in terms of drafting a code of conduct in the South China Sea, how much of its credibility do you think is affected by its actual actions on the ground, let's say in the South China Sea?
Because
ahead, sir.
Yeah, I understand the question, Kristen. I think that's for others to judge. You know, I think ASEAN has to come together as a group and form a position in regard to these matters. It's not for us to indicate to ASEAN what it should do, but I think ASEAN's considering all of these issues very closely. And I know that the Philippines, as a party to ASEAN, is looking at this in a very intense way to consider where it needs to come out over the coming years.
But they also buy the position of China, or the denial, consistent denial, that it doesn't have any maritime militia. But there is, or let's rephrase the question, that those deployed there in that area are not vessels which are part of the Chinese maritime militia.
Yes, well, I'm no maritime expert, but it would seem to me, and I think others have commented to this effect, that there is a maritime militia that is active in the South China Sea, and that, you know, we would see as not necessarily a positive move.
Okay. Now, as far as the Philippine government is concerned, how important do you think it is for this administration specifically to make sure that once and for all, it would get the international community involved in terms of dealing with China over this specific issue?
So, yeah, I think that's a matter for the Philippine government to work out. But I know that the Philippines is talking to a range of countries about the situation and, is developing its position. I think it's important that the Philippines stand up for its rights and articulate its position clearly. And I note that the Secretary of Defense and the Secretary of Foreign Affairs have done that in recent days quite precisely.
Okay. Now let's go to another raging issue, the ongoing pandemic. We know that, of course, just like the Philippines, although on a different scale or gravity, Australia is also dealing with this pandemic. In terms of let's say assistance, can we talk about this, for instance, how both countries are helping each other in terms of dealing with this pandemic?
Yeah, well, we've been talking to the Philippines throughout the pandemic and sharing our experiences both here and in Australia. I'm very pleased to say that Australia has been, you know, determined to provide assistance to its friend and partner in the Philippines. And going back to last December, our Prime Minister announced $500 million package for the Indo-Pacific to support COVID-19 recovery, and the second highest amount from that $500 million package is coming here to the Philippines. We've also been part of the COVAX facility. So you'll remember that about 3 weeks ago, the President was out at the airport with a group of ambassadors, me being one of them, to welcome the first arrival of COVAX vaccines. And that was AstraZeneca vaccines, about 480,000 of them arriving here in the Philippines. Well, we've been party to that COVAX facility. We're the vice chair of the Gavi group, which is part of COVAX. And we were instrumental in getting the Philippines to get one of the first deliveries of the COVAX vaccines. We've also used that money that the Prime Minister announced last December to work with Secretary Galvez, Secretary Duque and Vince Dizon to work out how it is that Australia can provide practical support to the Philippines in terms of overcoming the pandemic. And so what we've done is sit down and work out what the Philippines needs, and what we've been asked to do is to provide a range of technical assistance. So that is logistics, distribution, inoculation plans, to ensure that vaccines, when they do come, are rolled out right across the Philippines and that everybody gets access to the appropriate vaccines. And then on the 15th of March this month, our Prime Minister, together with those who form the Quad, announced another $100 million to ensure that in Southeast Asia, all the vaccines go the last mile. And that is going out to absolutely everyone so that we can create herd immunity here in the Philippines, as we're seeking to do back in Australia.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, by the way, let me clarify this. How much are we talking about here in terms of assistance being provided to the Philippines as part of this facility provided within the Indo-Pacific region?
So we're talking billions and billions of pesos.
Okay. So this will be stretched over a specific period of time, right?
Yes, it goes over 3 years.
Okay.
So we're starting in this financial year and then the next two financial years, because it will take a while for the Philippines, obviously, to develop that herd immunity, given the size of the population and the geographic diversity of the country. So we want to ensure that we're providing that assistance throughout the whole program. So that's what we've sought to do. So just last week, I've signed off the first tranche of this support, and so it will all start to flow as the vaccines come into the country.
Okay. Now, in terms of the pandemic response by the Philippines, which particular gaps do you think actually need specific improvement?
Well, I think where we're going to have, you know, the most practical impact, and this is what Australia's been asked to do, is how do you go beyond the immediate cities? You know, so the vaccine comes into the Philippines, it will then be distributed in the major cities. Mm-hmm. And here in Metro Manila, for example, each local government unit has its own plan for the distribution of vaccines around that area and looking after its city. But as you go further out into the countryside, how is that rollout going to be conducted? And that's where Australia is seeking to work with the Department of Health, the Department of Science and Technology, to work out what's actually needed in terms of refrigeration, distribution systems, and having the people trained as inoculators to actually issue the vaccine. That's where I think we're going to find that we really need to focus, because it's going to be difficult getting out to the more remote areas. And of course, Australia, because of its own diverse geographic situation, you know, with a massive continent, different types of environments, desert, tropics, you name it, we've got it. We're going to encounter all of this ourselves as we roll out the vaccine inoculation program in Australia. So we want to transfer our skills and our knowledge from Australia here to the Philippines.
Yeah, and of course, it's as you mentioned, it's very difficult also to compare, let's say, the terrain of Australia with the Philippines, because we're talking of two different countries, understandably.
Yeah. The principles will be the same, though, I think, Christian, of how do you deal with this, you know, because much of it's going to have to be done by air, to quite a degree, to get out to the various islands that we've got here in the Philippines, sometimes by ship, and working out the principles of transport and then distribution and inoculation, I think, will be very much the same.
Mm-hmm. How about contact tracing? What do you think is the most effective way to deal with that? Because this is also a persistent problem here in the Philippines, especially with the latest surge that we're seeing.
Yeah, contact tracing is a real issue. And I must admit, you know, in Australia too, we've been trying to refine our contact tracing protocols. I think here in the Philippines, that's a developing situation. As a matter of fact, I was up in Baguio just last week talking to Mayor Magalong, who's the contact tracing czar. And he was explaining to me the complexities of the situation here in the Philippines and the need to have further resources that, you know, go to the contact tracing piece. And that's just a matter of experience and time to build up that capability. But I must admit, I was deeply impressed by Mayor Benji Magalong and his work in support of the government.
Okay, Ambassador Stephen Robinson, thank you for joining us on the program, sir.
Thank you very much, Christian. Always a pleasure.
The stricter enhanced community quarantine, or ECQ, in Metro Manila, Rizal, Laguna, Cavite, and Bulacan begins today to prevent the novel coronavirus from spreading further. Curfew hours have been extended from 6 p.m. to 5 a.m. Only essential workers will be allowed to leave their homes, as well as those buying food or medicines. Gatherings of more than 10 people are also banned, while malls are closed except for groceries and drugstores. The new restrictions will be in effect until April 4.
Pagdating naman po sa detection, no? Mag-establish po kami tayo ng mga Daravi-like centers at the community na maghahanap po ng mga suspect cases, ititrace sila, i-contact trace at i-isolate. Magbabahay-bahay po tayo na maghahanap ng mga taong meron po mga simptomas. Isinasapinal na po ang pagbibigay ng assistance. Meron naman po tayong press briefing sa Lunes. Sa Lunes po, nag-commit po ang ating economic team na unang-una, malalaman na kung saan kukunin yung pagkuhanan natin ng assistance at pangalawa, kung magkano yung assistance at kung ano yung pamamaraan para madistribute ito.
The Health Professionals Alliance supports the shift to ECQ, but it appeals to the government to boost the COVID-19 referral network for hospitals and to intensify contact tracing efforts. The group also calls for transportation for health workers and the strict adherence to the priority list of COVID-19 vaccine recipients. The Philippines records more than 9,000 new COVID-19 cases for the third straight day. This brings the country's total number of infections to over 721,000. Over 105,000 of them are considered active cases. 11 more people died of the disease, raising the death toll to 13,170. Recoveries stand at more than 603,000. Based on the latest data, the country's positivity rate is now at nearly 20%. That means one out of five people tested is positive for the disease. The World Health Organization recommends a positivity rate of 5% or lower for at least 14 days before reopening the economy. Over 9,000 police officers have been deployed to quarantine control checkpoints across the National Capital Region and nearby provinces. Unlike last year's enhanced community quarantine situation, the body temperatures of those passing through will be no longer checked. Instead, authorized workers will only be asked to present their valid company IDs or certificates of employment. Authorities promise to be flexible in the implementation of ECQ restrictions, assuring maximum tolerance and no arrests as much as possible.
Papabalikin sila o warningan, tapos yung ordinansa na inisyu ng mga NGOs, i-issuean sila ng ticket. Kanina, hinighlight doon, dapat mayroong mga gym na pwedeng pagdalhan sa kanila, papanoorin sila ng paalala para sa patupad itong ECQ. Yung arrest, hanggat maaari, maliban na lang siguro kung sila ay talagang magiging hostile o makakasakit na hindi lang sa police o kung kanino man, doon papasok yun.
We will be compassionate for those who are on their way home. Alam naman po ng ating mga kapulisan at mga barangay yan. Kaya lang, may window po yan. Pagka nakarating po ng mga 7:30 to 8 o'clock, maghihigpit na po talaga yan dahil yung nilaan na duration po ng travel nyo ay hindi na po siguro maaaring ganun katagal pa.
The public is prohibited from attending Holy Week celebrations in the so-called NCR Plus after the government placed those areas on the strictest lockdown classification for a week. From Holy Monday to Easter Sunday, churches in Metro Manila, Bulacan, Cavite, Laguna, and Rizal will be closed. Religious celebrations will also be held online, similar to last year when the pandemic began. Catholic Bishops' Conference of the Philippines reminds the public to observe health protocols and to pray for those who are suffering the most amid the COVID-19 pandemic. Workers affected by stricter quarantine measures in Metro Manila and nearby provinces are appealing for help from the government. Some public utility drivers fear mobility restrictions will further slash their earnings. Other delivery drivers, meanwhile, say the closure of most establishments will likely affect their work.
Katulad ho namin bumibiyahe sa TNBS po. Andalang ho ng pasero. Wala na hong lumalabas eh. Siyempre, magbaboundary pa ho kami. Magkano lang naman ho ang sa maghapon na kitain.
Sana pagkatapos itong isang linggo na ito, sana maibalik naman yung magandang biyaya na sa susunod na linggo po.
Pinapahirapan na rin yung tao eh. Mga taong bayan eh. Lockdown na lockdown eh. Saan mahanap ng pera? Alam, pambayad sa araw-araw bahay, sumusabuhanan ng bahay, tubig, ilaw. Kung na-lockdown yan, eh, wala naman tayong anak buhay na iba na naman.
Pero kagabi po,
Malacanang has said aid will be given during a one-week enhanced community quarantine period. But details like how much and when the assistance will become available are still being finalized. The government also promises to distribute food packs in poor communities. A group calls on big companies to pay their employees who will not be able to report to work during the implementation of the enhanced community quarantine. The Employers Federation of the Philippines, or ECOP, says the ECQ will have minimal impact on most companies since it falls during the Holy Week when most firms are implementing reduced working hours anyway. But ECOP says employees who will be most affected are those under the No Work, No Pay scheme. ECOP now calls on big firms to waive such policy during the one-week ECQ.
So, pinapakiusapan namin yung malalaking, ala ka magagawa doon sa mga micro eh. Talaga, hindi mo naman sila pwede magbayad ng ano. Pero yung malalaki na miyembro namin, pinapakiusapan namin, sana kargahin na lang nyo yung Lunes, Martes, Miyerkules na ano, para hindi naman masyadong mahirapan yung mga tao nila.
Public transportation will remain available but with limited capacity in Metro Manila and nearby provinces under the enhanced community quarantine. Starting today, Transportation Secretary or Undersecretary Artemio Ochi Tuason says public transport vehicles will be limited to authorized persons outside of the residences. At the Ninoy Aquino International Airport, only 1,500 international inbound passengers will be accepted daily, while maritime transport will be limited at 50% capacity. Trains will only run up to 30% capacity, although the MRT, the LRT, the PNR have already announced they will be closed until Easter Sunday due to maintenance work. Provincial bus stations will also have limited operations.
Siguro nga medyo natatakot pa yung mga kababayan natin na lumabas para dahil nga sa sinasabi nilang lockdown. Halos yung mga nasasakay lang namin, yung mga nagtatrabaho.
Regular po ang biyahe namin. Yung pasahero, kumunti nga lalo. Pero bilang transport service, ginagawa pa rin po namin yung aming trabaho na maglingkod pa rin, magservisyo pa rin. Nag-adjust lang kami sa mga bebiyaheng bus.
Panic buying was seen in several stores in Metro Manila just moments after the government announced stricter quarantine restrictions in areas under the so-called NCR Plus bubble. Online orders also soared as people chose not to line up at supermarkets, but the government assured the public there won't be a shortage in supplies.
Wala pong dahilan para mag-panic buying. Hindi po tayo mauubusan dahil bukas naman po ang mga merkado.
The Agriculture Department also said the delivery of products and agricultural input will not be hampered due to the new restrictions. Power utility firm Meralco suspends all disconnection activities until April 15. Meralco says the move is meant to ease the burden of its customers during the enhanced community quarantine. Meralco earlier announced it would continue vital operations such as meter readings despite stricter quarantine measures. It also urges customers to reach out to them online for an inquiry as a precaution to the rising number of COVID-19 cases. Up next, what's it like to reach the third deepest spot on Earth? We asked the Filipino scientists who achieved this feat. After this short break, Matters of Fact will be right back. Stay with us.
Tingnan nyo, oh! Puti ito!
Mas puti ito!
Mas puti ito! Mas puti ito! Mas puti ito!
Very often we know in conflict areas, the most of the population that has been affected is actually women and girls and all peoples. So to be able to reach out in some of these areas. When it comes also to culture, you need to have women peacekeepers to actually be able to talk to people and getting what is going on in a society. Very often we know in conflict areas, the most of the population that has been affected is actually women and girls and all peoples. So to be able to reach out in some of these areas, when it comes also to culture, you need to have women peacekeepers to actually be able to talk to people and getting what is going on in a society.
Of the Philippine Trench in the third deepest spot on Earth. Last week, that's exactly what Dr. Deo Onda of the University of the Philippines' Marine Science Institute was able to do, even waving the country's flag after the successful dive. For more on this historic deep-sea exploration, we are joined by Dr. Onda himself. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us again on the program, and congratulations.
Thank you, Prof. Christian. Good morning, and good morning to everyone who's watching your show. Okay, and thank you very much for the greetings.
Okay, we're all excited to hear your story. How was it under there? Third deepest spot on Earth.
Even though it's part of the Earth, it's actually out of this world. It's something that I had not seen on the surface of the Earth before. It's something I'm actually very excited to share to the Filipino people. The experience itself was surreal, but more than that, I think accomplishing my promise during the interview I had with you, the promise to actually wave that flag and symbolically assert the sovereign rights of the Filipinos to that extension of marine heritage we have. I think that privilege of doing that is already a big honor.
Okay.
So yeah, I felt very... accomplished and also very happy that it was already finished.
How long was the descent and how long did you stay under?
Yeah, I'm actually quite amazed with the accuracy of the physics and the science that went around the expedition. During the pre-dive, I was oriented. There was an orientation telling me that, you know, it would take around 4 hours. And exactly after descending at 6:30 in the morning, we were at the bottom at 10:30 a.m. So the entire trip going down took around 4 hours. And then me and Victor had 3 hours to sort of explore, go around the area. You know, the scientist and me kicked in, and then I was trying to find things. I was trying to discover new things. And then another 4 years, 4 years, four hours going up to the surface.
So how long did you stay?
That was around 12 hours.
Okay. How long did we stay?
We had a bottom time of around 3 to 3.5 hours, which is actually quite long because usually
And what did you see there?
Yeah, 3 to 3.5 hours because usually they would only stay around that time for the bottom time.
Mm. And of course, the other source of the other object of curiosity. What did you see there? Go ahead, sir. Yeah. What did you see there? Down there?
Yeah. The Emden Deep itself was very quiet. Yeah, it was very quiet. It was very quiet. It was very, should I say, out of this world. You know, we've seen Martian movies. We've seen surfaces of other planets. It felt that way, actually, should I say. Mm. It was very quiet, though I felt that the world slowed down by 10 times when I was down there. When we touched the bottom, we disturbed a bit of the sediments or the sand, and it moved so slowly. It's something that I have not experienced before in any of my dives. It's something that I have not seen before. To be honest, I was expecting that there would be a lot of creepy organisms running away from us as we actually went down the Emden Deep. But surprisingly, when we reached the bottom, it was just very quiet. I did not see a lot of organisms. There were not any megalodons or giant squids. But there were a lot of other small creatures. There were a lot of amphipods and other organisms that we have not yet identified. Mm. You know, when you are inside the sub, the view is also a bit constricted and limited. So we are now relying on the cameras that we have that surrounded the sub. If there had been any organisms that we've missed, we're trying to review the footages now. We have 9 cameras surrounding the sub plus within the sub. So that's a lot of footages to actually review. So that's what I am doing in the next few days. And hopefully, we'll be able to compile everything and then share it to the Filipino people.
So as far as feeling is concerned, it was both surreal and serene, right? Down there. But I'd like to go to the importance
of... Yes, it's very serene.
Mm-hmm. The organisms that you saw there, you mentioned that some of them were unidentified still. I mean, this in itself could be a feat because it's not every day that people get to visit that third deepest spot on Earth. Right? It's dark, it's serene, and there might be organisms there that we haven't seen.
True. You know, but as a scientist, I would actually first validate before concluding that those are actually new organisms or it's just, something that we have just not seen in the Emden Deep but have already been reported somewhere else. Mm-hmm. So those are two different things. So what we will do is to actually collaborate also with the National Museum of Natural History in the Philippines. We want to give them some of the footages that we have. Although this is not a scientific mission in itself, there were still a lot of new observations that might be of scientific value to the Filipino scientific community and to the National Museum itself. So that's what we will try to do after this. There are a lot of new information on the Emden Deep itself, you know. Even though there were not a lot of organisms seen, at least I think the new information or the observations that we had, first time that we were able to see what the Emden Deep and the Philippine Trench looks like will actually be a valuable information to our geologists because it will really confirm a lot of their theories and a lot of their hypotheses. Mm. So that's what we're trying to do right now, to actually donate this data, make it publicly available for Filipino scientific community to be able to use it.
And of course also to share the information and the stories that you have, having been the first Filipino to be able to see that, right?
Yeah. And I think, Christian, one of the few things that I did not expect, and it was funny because many people were telling me before I went down, they were telling me, oh, Deo, good luck there, and hopefully you'd not see a lot of plastics because plastics had been reported in the Marianas Trench. And to tell you honestly, the entire experience was very surreal until I saw this one floating debris. And we went closer to it, and it was actually plastics. And as we actually went closer to the wall, which means the side going to the Philippine side, we'd seen more more of this, more of the marine debris. So I was pulled back into reality that it is actually not out of this world, because the mere fact that I was able to see marine contamination from human activity at 10,000 meters below is something that really, you know, it was a punch in the gut that what we are doing up there or somewhere else will always affect an environment in the marine, will always affect a certain section of the marine environment. And those are actually some of the things I did not want to see, but sadly, we were able to observe them.
That's very unfortunate. It simply meant that our bad habits up here are also being felt down there, no?
Yes. So it is a visual evidence, you know, and I hope to actually share more of this in the coming days as we finish reviewing some of the footages. But it is actually a strong evidence of the extent of the pollution and the effects that humans actually have in the marine environment.
Okay. So,
you know, I was actually a bit sad. I was joking down there. Apparently, this is not the first time that humans were able to reach the Endem Deep. Their pollution and their trash had been there long before us. Mm. So that's very sad.
That was the first to arrive, the imprint of human garbage, first to arrive down there before the human being was actually able to visit that, which is also very, very unfortunate indeed. I'd like to go to the shirt that you were wearing there. Was it after or during the dive?
No, it was during.
Okay.
It was during the dive. I really reserved that shirt for that dive.
I just need to ask this, but of course, the answer is quite obvious, definitely. The statement written was, Ate ng Pilipinas, right? And above that, there was an image of the Philippine map, right? Okay. What was your goal, personally, as far as the other aspect is concerned? Because you knew that people were naturally curious, very excited for you for this dive. On one part, basically scientifically, but on the other, you try to make sure that you'll be able to use that platform to issue a very strong statement.
Yes, as I've said in my past interviews, and I think including your interview, Christian, before I dive, that one of the main goals is to let the Filipinos and the Philippine nation be reminded of the vastness of our marine resources and therefore the vastness of our marine territories. The waving of the flag is really the objective that we assert our sovereign rights there. But I realized that I was also given this platform, taking into consideration that many Filipinos had been interested in this journey and in this expedition. I used that platform to remind them of the vastness of our marine waters. And that included having that shirt, assert that Ate ng Pinas, which means that these are the waters that we have, these are the marine resources we have. I also thought personally, this is a personal opinion of mine, that it was very poetic, because as we assert our waters on the right side of the Philippines, there is something that is happening in the West Philippine Sea. And I hope the symbolic assertion that I did on the right side of the Philippines in the Philippine Trench, where humans had not been before, I hope it's the same symbolic assertion that we do in the waters that we have in the West of the Philippine Sea, especially with what is happening right now there. And that is something that I would like to remind the Filipino people, that we have the power to actually help and also call on the government to help us assert our sovereign rights in these waters. And I hope it would just put more emphasis on that.
Finally, I'd like to give this opportunity for you, not just that particular historic dive, to talk about your personal frustrations as a scientist, as a Filipino, over what's happening in the West Philippine Sea on the left side, and how the government has been handling or dealing with the situation. And if this particular political statement that you were able to deliver after that dive somehow helped you deal with this kind of frustration, if it was cathartic, for instance?
You know, I'm part of the government. I'm an employee of the government. And the only thing that we wanted to do here is to also help the government in ways that we can. After this expedition, I will be going there to actually do marine scientific research. We are all in this together, I should say. And there's no point now to actually do the, you know, blaming game. But I think what I did was to represent what most of the Filipinos feel, what most of the Filipinos actually want, and that is to assert our sovereign rights in the waters that we have. As a government employee myself, what I will do after this is lead an expedition to the West Philippine Sea. And that would also be part of the assertion of our sovereign rights in those waters, because marine scientific research activity is done and can be done in the exclusive economic zone of the Philippines. On the part of being a scientist, yes, I've also repeatedly included in my posts that there is a need to recognize the contribution of the Filipino scientists. And that is very poignant because, you know, as a government employee and as a scientist of the people through the University of the Philippines, many of the researchers within the university are actually experiencing injustices in terms of delays in salaries, in terms of having not much benefits, you know. And we would like to call on the university and the government on that let's put more emphasis and also attention to the needs of the Filipino scientists. Filipino scientists can accomplish a lot if we are actually given the proper platform, the proper support and recognition. And I hope this would just, you know, there was a post from the Secretary Boy De La Peña of the Department of Science and Technology, and I'd like to thank the DOST for the support of that. But I hope more than the post and the greetings, we actually go beyond. Let's actually talk about how can Filipino scientists contribute more to the development and national growth of the country, because there are a lot of opportunities in the oceans right now. The Philippines is preparing to gear towards blue economy or the ocean-based economy. And this is a manifestation and a demonstration of what Filipino scientists, marine scientists can actually contribute. So, you know, I hope this activity would not only be historically significant, but it would also put emphasis and call attention of the government and the officials that we have on certain national issues that we need to consider. So I hope, yeah, it goes beyond that the discussions would actually go more beyond the dive itself, but also the issues that surround it.
Okay, Professor Adeo Onda, thank you very much for joining us on the program. And again, congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Christian.
President Rodrigo Duterte celebrated his 76th birthday on Sunday in Davao City. Several officials greeted the chief executive, such as his spokesman Harry Roque and Vice President Len Robredo. Duterte is expected to fly back to Manila today for the arrival of 1 million more doses of COVID vaccines from China's Chinese firm Sinovac. The city of Manila began vaccinating its senior citizens using AstraZeneca's coronavirus vaccine on Sunday. An initial 8,000 doses were administered, but a lot more is needed to inoculate all the city's nearly 150,000 senior citizens.
Para po yung aming mga senior citizens ay hindi na mahirapan. So nag-community po kami. 12 po ito ngayon, simultaneous, ongoing sa buong Maynila. Ito pong mga napili namin na barangay na ito, ito po yung mga barangay na with the highest of pre-registered. Pero tuloy-tuloy po kami hanggang maubos namin yung vaccines namin.
Saka gusto ako na rin po. Kaya ano, nagpa-injection ako ngayon. Kasi natatakot din ako eh. Halos lahat naman ng tao natatakot, kaya kailangan din talaga ito.
Quezon City, 86% of more than 17,000 healthcare workers have already received their first dose of a COVID-19 vaccine. The local government also plans to start inoculating senior citizens and people with comorbidities by Tuesday. As for Marikina, the city has vaccinated about 5,000 medical frontliners, while almost 3,000 are still waiting in line. It will start vaccinating other priority sectors once it gets more vaccine supplies this week. Valenzuela City, meanwhile, aims to finish vaccinating all of its senior citizens on Wednesday. Other priority groups will be inoculated after Holy Week. Now, the chairperson of the Metro Manila Council asserts that mayors are legally qualified to be vaccinated against COVID-19 along with health workers because they are also considered frontliners. Parañaque City Mayor Edwin Olivares claims that statement also came from the health department last Saturday when he spoke with officials about the mayors who were given show cause orders for jumping the priority list. Olivares says the DOH considers them qualified as chairpersons of their local health board, but he also admits the controversy is an issue of honor, considering the country is still short on vaccines. Undersecretary Ipimaco Densing has said the mayors did not need to jump the COVID-19 vaccine line because they have already been bumped up the country's priority list. Densing said governors, mayors, and village chiefs are now fourth in line when they were initially eighth on the list of the priority sectors. Let's now get more reactions on the stricter lockdown being implemented in the national capital region and nearby provinces to curb the spread of the novel coronavirus. Dr. Tony Lechon joins us this morning. He's a former advisor of the Philippines' COVID-19 Task Force. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Good morning, Christian. Good morning.
Okay, so Metro Manila and neighboring provinces are back to an enhanced community quarantine. One basic question is, are we back to where we started last year after more than a year of one of the strictest lockdowns in the world?
I think we're back to square one, but worse than last year, given that our problems are not only COVID, but we have also non-COVID cases right now, cases on an upswing. And these are ischemic heart diseases, strokes, of course, diabetes mellitus, and other diseases. And the second problem is that we have a bigger base right now compared to last year. And it would be very difficult to control, considering that we're hovering into the 9 to 10,000 daily. And for the third straight day, we are on the more than 9,000 cases. And the positivity rate is quite high. We're nearly 20%, and that's one in every five, for every five persons test. And that is really quite alarming. And it will be very difficult to address this with 1 week ECQ. And perhaps if I would suggest maybe 2 weeks ECQ and then reevaluate the positivity rate and the reproduction number.
So your suggestion is a two-week ECQ, is that correct?
Yes, because the base is actually greater right now. We have more active cases right now, 100,000, more than 100,000 cases. We have reached the 700,000 mark, and it will be very difficult given the situation that we have right now. And we have limited vaccine supply, and that would aggravate the problem. The other thing that is different from last year, we have five other variants aside from the Chinese Wuhan strain, and which makes it more transmissible at this moment.
Okay. Now, the other issue is, why did we come to this? Supposedly, all the significant measures have been put in place long ago, but yet we're still experiencing this latest surge. Where do you attribute this this latest problem that we're seeing now?
Well, I think there's lack of rigor in terms of monitoring the cases from the health department side, because as you can see that every 4 o'clock they have this announcement of the data, but I'm not sure whether they're really mining the data. You see slowly creeping in or creeping up of the data since February. And the premature opening of the economy sent different signals or mixed signals to the community, resulting in social mobility. And then they were not able to address the variants B117 that came in January. And I was alarmed last February 10 when the South African variant was found and then resulted in the termination of the vaccine, that's the AstraZeneca. And border control was imposed. In fact, travel bans were lifted for B117. And then
there was limited vaccine supply.
Okay.
And then, to make matters worse, they even requested for, the IATF requested for a modified GCQ on March 1, which was overruled by the president, considering the limited vaccine supply. And after 4 days, they started the upswing of the cases, leading to 9,000 every day for the last 3 days.
Okay. Now,
so
yet,
think, basically, Christian, I'm sorry. Hmm. It's a confluence of all the events leading to this particular second surge.
Okay. So, sorry for cutting you off there. But I'd also like to get your reaction coming from a former advisor to the National Task Force on COVID-19. Because despite the situation now, despite the shortcomings that were definitely there since last year, you heard Malacanang describe the government's pandemic response as excellent, right? Is that really the case? Is that accurate?
It's not accurate and it's not transparent. Ever since when I left the National Task Force, one of the main things that I actually articulated was the lack of transparent, open and candid communication, the lack of a sense of urgency, and of course, timely data, analysis that would actually give sound policy. So basically, if you say that we are excellent in terms of our pandemic response, why are we on ECQ right now? And basically, that sends a wrong signal to the community, because that will lead to even further non-compliance to the health protocols. So you will not have the moral ascendancy to tell the people to adhere to the health protocols when you're saying that we are excellent and some of the public officials pushing for adherence to the health protocol are actually afflicted with COVID, like spokesperson Harry Roque, Secretary Ramon Lopez, and even the PNP chief, the Bolsinas. Mm-hmm. So these are quite, frustrating to the Filipino people, considering that the persons who are supposed to lead this are the ones afflicted and sending wrong signals to the community.
Okay, finally, Dr. Liachon, of course, we know that certain government officials are very sensitive to criticism. They don't like being blamed here, right? But on the other hand, that can also be seen as the people's way of seeking accountability from our government officials, because they are the ones who are there. They're supposed to lead this pandemic response. We know that this is also a shared responsibility, but a lot of that responsibility also rests on those running the government. In this case, how much of this problem that we're seeing now is actually or can be attributed to incompetence or even at the highest levels?
This is about 80% leadership problem. As you know, right now, Dr. Deborah Briggs from the U.S. just admitted that the failure in the U.S. response is secondary to the poor leadership of Donald Trump. And I would say this would also be likened to the situation in the country. This is all about leadership. And if only we could do something about it and we're given this opportunity to correct our mistakes, I think we should actually step up on the plate right now, considering the people are waiting for results.
Okay. Dr. Tony Liachon, thank you for joining us this morning, sir.
Thank you very much, Christian. Good morning.
And that's our program for today. I'm Christian Esguera. You can listen to our interviews again on the Matters of Fact podcast on Spotify, Google, Apple, and Stitcher. You can also get other exclusive content on ANC's YouTube channel. Thank you for watching.
Magandang gabi, bayan.
Stay updated with the daily issues and current events.
Tulad po ng aming pinangako, nagbabalik ang ating TV Patrol.
With the Philippines' leading local evening newscast. The national stories presented to you by the country's trusted anchors and reporters. TV Patrol. Watch it weeknights here on the ABS-CBN News Channel.